So today, tonight, I was asked to talk about some recent developments in Turkey, but I said that recent developments won't make sense without the historical background. As a historian, I have to go back to history as much as I can. We're not going to go back to Adam and Eve, but we will start with the Ottomans at least. Because really, in order to understand what's going on in Turkey, we really need to understand that connection to the Ottoman Empire. Although in history there seems to be a break between the Ottomans and the Turkish Republic. That is the official part of the official history, that everything about the Ottomans is past and there was a totally new page opened with the Turkish Republic. Well, as historians, when we look back in history, we understand that there is much more to it. It is much more complicated than that. And indeed, more recent studies on Turkish history always start with a phrase like that. From the Ottomans to the Republic, economy. From the Ottomans to the Republic, diplomacy, or education. So in all sorts of fields, we start to explore more and more those roots of what is in Turkey today, going back to the Ottoman Empire, especially the last period of the Ottoman Empire, starting in as early as 1839. That is when really there was the first major Europeanization effort to modernize the Ottomans, to introduce major reforms, and even changing the dynamics of relationship between the state, the typical imperial relation where the Sultan is at the top and everyone else is the subjects, more in terms of more modern citizenship kind of equal status to everyone kind of relationship. And then we see the first attempt to establish a parliament and bring in a constitution as early as 1878, and then again in early 20th century, 1908, there was a constitutional period, as it is called, established at the end of Abdul Hamid's rule. I don't know what's going on with the computer. But something interesting, although Abdul Hamid is very well known for being an oppressive, a very authoritarian sultan, a lot of the reforms that he introduced are at the roots of what we have in Turkey, especially in the early Republican periods. A lot of educational reforms, new schools were opened, especially for the military, but those schools were the ones where officers like Mustafa Kemal Atatürk were raised. They were educated there by European professors from Germany, from France. A lot of students were sent to Europe, to France, to Paris. That is where they got the ideas of nationalism, which would end up establishing the Turkish Republic as a nation state. So it is under Abdul Hamid's reign that we see all those ideas flourishing that would pave the ground for the establishment of the Turkish Republic. So after the Ottomans, starting in 1920 when the first parliament was assembled under Atatürk's leadership, we can see the beginnings of the modern Turkish Republic. Well, Turkey, the new state, had to be different. It had to be modern. It had to be at the same level as the other European countries. That is why there's a big emphasis on the West, westernization, being like Europe, being like European countries in every aspect. And we should also remember the Wilsonian concept at the time, the Wilsonian idea, which is that giving the right to self-determination to every ethnic group. He specifically mentioned that Turks need to have their own state, but every other ethnic group within the Ottoman Empire also should be eligible to have their own state. So that was his idea, but that was also the prevalent idea at the time. That is why we see an emphasis on establishing a modern state based on an ethnic identity. That's why it had to be Turkey, based on the Turkish ethnic identity, so that it could be a legitimate state from the Western perspective at the time. And this westernization reached out to all aspects, all aspects of the time. So, So it is not just political, it is not just establishing a republic, but it went all the way to cultural areas, going every aspect of the society. So new reforms included education reform. All the schools had to be were united under one leadership, under the education of the Ministry of Education. The script, a new script was introduced to break away from the Ottoman past and to bring Turkey closer to Europe, which is the Latin script. That is how you're able to read some of the Turkish words when you're in Turkey. Otherwise, it would all be the Ottoman, the Arabic script. It is the same language, Turkish language, but written with different letters. The hat, for example, was introduced. That is one of the most interesting reforms that were introduced. It is still a law. All men in Turkey have to wear a hat. It's a fedora, actually. Because in the Ottoman times, hat was a symbol of your status. People distinguish each other by their headgear. If they had the turban, for example, in a specific style, it meant that you were a professor. If you had the fez, it meant that you were a bureaucrat. So again, the hat represents, in a symbolic way, a break from the past and a new beginning into a European way, into a European standard. And in all these reforms under Ataturk, they are brought down to, crystallized down to six major aspects. And those six are summarized in those words: secularism, nationalism, statism, republicanism, populism, and revolutionism. But among all these six, we see that the first two actually became the most, detrimental and influential in Turkey. Secularism and nationalism. Well, secularism meant, as we know, separation of state and church. But actually, there are different types of secularism. More recently, there has been literature developing, scholars identifying, distinguishing between the American way, largely, of secularism, where the state approaches with a hands-off approach to the religious institutions, so religions are free to operate in the society. People are free to display their religious choice, and the state does not interfere as long as religion does not overcome politics or go into politics. But then on the other hand, there is a French-style secularism where the state takes an active role in making sure that the religious symbols do not appear in public, in the society. So the state is actively involved in a way, suppressing religion and religious symbolism in public sphere. And the Turkish version is closer to the French version. Actually, some argue that it is even further than the French version, but it is more in line with the French, because, understandably so, because at the time all the leaders of the Republic had been educated, or most of them were influenced by the French style, the French society, and the French model. Until 1950s, we could say that the French model was more influential in Turkey than America. It is something that is attributed to the party that ruled, the single party that ruled until 1940s, late 1940s. There created, during that time period, a new elite formed. Those who were able to go to the schools, those who could attend and go beyond the primary school and go attend in the high schools, and then the few, very few universities. There were two or three universities for most of the decades until 80s. So those few individuals who could get the education, then they had access to all the positions in the state, they had access to businesses. So they emerged as the elite of the Republican period, we could say. And that elite then increasingly was detached from the larger public. And that is why the larger public was viewed as ignorant, They don't know. We make the choices for them. This is better for them. And that is, in a way, why we don't really see the multi-party system until 1946. Yes, there was a single party regime from 1923 all the way until 1946. And only in 1946, with some pressure from the United States, actually, in return to joining NATO and joining the Western camp, there was a transition to a multi-party system where there were multiple parties in elections. The Republican People's Party was the only party during that time period. There were an attempt to establish another one, but it failed. And from 1950 to 1960, the alternative party, the second party, won the elections, three elections in a row, the Democrat Party. And so we see a transition towards democracy. And that was pretty much always the intention, the focus, the aim from the very beginning was to achieve the level of democracy that is in the West. But then, democracy has not been as smooth in Turkey, and there has been coups. The picture that you see there is the head of the Democrat Party, Adnan Menderes, who led Turkey for 10 years, but then as a result of the coup, he was hanged after a mock trial. It was not the only coup. There was another military intervention in 1971, another one in 1980. Another one, it is called a postmodern coup, but it is because it is not a traditional military takeover, but it led to a collapse of the elected government in 1997, and another one in 2007, and that one is called e-coup, because it was an electronic, the military just posted something online, but it failed there. It did not really achieve any damage, but that was the last attempt by the military to intervene in regular politics. The military, although we see that the foreground during the coups, it was not really the only factor in bringing those coups. There are the elite controlled institutions which helped those processes. The judiciary was important. The higher education, universities played an important role. The media played an active role. In unison, inviting the generals to intervene in politics. Similarly, major business associations also helped bring the coups. So does this mean that Turkey was stuck and was not going anywhere? No. The society was constantly growing and developing, and the changes, the transformations, brought up a totally new dynamic in Turkey by the time when we get to 1980s, 90s. And the way I see it, at the root of that change lies urbanization. Urbanization brought the people from the villages to the cities. And this is the chart. You can't read the numbers there, but they are not really important. That's why I made it so small. What is important is just looking at these pie pieces. So what do you think the red symbolizes? Very good. And the blue? Very good. And what time period would you guess that is? It starts there, so it's a little bit early. Like if you can, everything, so it goes back to 1950. Around 1950, it was about 75% to 80% actually. Rural, and about 20% in the cities. That also gives us an idea, and the population is much smaller too, that gives us an idea of how the elite, although it was small, it was able to control so much in the country. But over time, and very rapidly, sorry, I'm revealing all my secrets. Every decade, this percentage has changed. So by the time you get to 1990s, this is totally reversed. And today, it is completely reversed, about 20% in rural, living in rural Turkey, and about 80% living in the cities. It's a huge change, a profound transformation in Turkey as a result of very rapid urbanization. This is not unique. This is not unique to Turkey. It happened in other countries, in America, maybe in early 20th century, in other countries, in different time periods, with similar results. When people move at a sudden, rapid pace to the cities, you have, of course, it's not controlled, it is not government designed, so you have shanty towns, irregular, unstructured areas where people start living. And then there are new fields of opportunities that are born, actually, because more people need, kids need schools, so more schools, more teachers, more businesses, more stores, more groceries, more malls, more housing. Then people start making money and they want to move to better housing. So you're still in Istanbul, you see all those cranes and huge construction still going on. There is still a lot of people moving into Istanbul. And of course, it is not just this new people coming into the cities, but it also changes the very dynamic of the society in terms of a new middle class is born. Now, different people can afford more pricey things, more expensive things, and they can move to the new areas. In the past, where certain areas were just confined for the top elite, very rich people, today you see different kinds of people hanging around in those shopping malls, which are originally meant for the rich elite, the white Turks, that actually became a concept. White Turks, the old elite, now is being challenged by the black Turks who are coming from these villages, and now they're making money, the women driving Mercedes, and it is something unusual. And that is how religious symbols become more visible now. That is why there is that misconception that Turkey is becoming more religious. No, Turkey is not becoming more religious. Religion is becoming more visible in Turkey as a result of this whole process. You have this sweet girl back in the village, you know, there's nothing scary about her. She is working in the village and wearing a scarf, as every villager girl would do. But then, with the change, she moves to the city, she goes to the high school and then the university, she graduates from the university, and she's still wearing a scarf, but in a different way. But this becomes a little bit scarier, because I don't know what she's going to do with that. Right? In the city, there's all sorts of opportunities. So this becomes what I call spatial democratization. In the past, there was more of a spatial discrimination, separation, a strict separation between where people, in a way in America or in Canada too, maybe, I don't know, like the downtown areas are reserved more for the poor, people living in poverty, who can't afford buying two cars so that they can move out of the city, who can't afford buying a suburban house, etc. They remain in the city center. And then it's called the plight of the white in the books. So after World War II, you have all these whites moving out to the suburbs, and it creates that separation, segregation in a way. It's not official, but socially, practically, it exists there. It is still there, actually, today. And in Turkey, we had a similar thing, and now it's being challenged with this transformation and the emergence of a new class, new middle class in the cities. So this is a change. And when we go over history, we always change, we always talk about changes and continuities. Some things change, but some things remain the same. And part of it is people's need to learn about their religion. People's need to study their faith. And this continued from the Ottoman times in terms of new communities. Religious communities were being born in the Republican Turkey, in modern Turkey, in a sort of modern way. In terms of almost like social movements. In the past, you had the Sufi lodges in the Ottoman Empire. They were very important. They had access to the people. People satisfied their religious needs by attending these Sufi lodges. But over time, they became backwards, or they were criticized for the backwardness of the Ottoman Empire. And in the early Republic, with the reforms, they were shut down. So no more officially, they couldn't exist. But unofficially, they were always there. They always remained, they always continued to function in the society, sometimes underground, sometimes openly, but they always were there for the people. You have the birth of new kind of religious groups and communities. As early as 1920s, you have Said Nursi, who was the predecessor, you could say, the guide for Fethullah Gulen, Said Nursi. He lived until 1960s. He's famous for the Epistles of Light that he wrote, large volumes of writing. And pretty much what he argued was that Muslims need to embrace modernity. They need to go through schooling, they need to go through education, they need to study the sciences, they should not be afraid of the sciences. They're not atheistic, they're not gonna make you, you know, communist, but you should embrace it. The sciences should bring you closer to God. The sciences can serve your religious purposes as well. So that brings up education. That brings an emphasis to education. And imagine all those people moving into the cities and they hear about this even religious guidance that you should go to the school and not be afraid of schooling. Then all of those people are now attending, girls as well, boys and girls. And that is what, again, prepares the grounds for the later movement led by Fethullah Gulen, which is called today the Hizmet movement, or the service. Hizmet means service in Turkish, which emphasizes education and dialogue. As early as 1970s, he started building institutions of education, dorms for students, university preparatory courses, and then private schools, and then universities. And now there are hundreds of them, and over time they opened up across the border and into Central Asia and all over the world today. And it's always education, schooling, and together with it, dialogue, emphasizing interfaith dialogue, as in this picture, meeting with the Pope was a major step in opening up to the world. And also today, the movement emphasizes, in terms of its general values, political values, that it upholds democratization, freedoms, rule of law, and similar universal values. So that is what's going on at the society level. At the political level, I have to cut through a lot because I'm already over my time that I set for myself. The rise of the AK Party is a major development for the last 10 years of Turkey. Justice and Development Party led by Recep Tayyip Erdogan. He identified his party's ideology as conservative democracy, and it became increasingly popular from 36% in 2002 to 42% in 2007 and 50% in 2011 in a multi-party system where there are 16 parties going into elections. This is a huge, unheard of track for the party. And why is it so popular? What is this? What's up with this guy that so many Turks vote for him? There are other factors as well, but for their credit, first of all, there is the economic change is so dramatic. There was a major economic crisis in 2001. I came to the United States in 2000, and when I was coming, everyone was telling me, don't come back, stay in the United States. Turkey is going bankrupt. You have to stay there. I said, I don't know, we'll see. And now, there are all sorts of opportunities in Turkey. They're calling me back, come back and start working here. And it's so hard to find jobs in America because of all the recession and everything. So the economic change is very dramatic. That is one thing that makes them so popular. There are all sorts of other numbers that indicate the success, but we don't need to go into that. And democratization is another function that they led in Turkey. Especially in the first period, in the first 3, 4, 5 years of their governance, there's a major effort, major drive towards the European Union, joining European Union, making advancements, and they did take a few serious steps on the way to becoming a European Union member, But then after around 2007, we see a slowdown and eventually a halt. In the last 2-3 years, there hasn't really been much on that front. But it is also this, all these reforms with European Union also affected democratization within Turkey, the military, the role of the military. In all sorts of ways, it was curtailed. The military was brought, the democratically elected government was brought higher in terms of importance than the military. Other institutions that we mentioned earlier that represented the old elite were now transformed and they became more open to the larger public. And in terms of their foreign policy as well, they made statements which were more nationalistic. They aroused the patriotic feelings in the people. They made them feel strong and influential, at least in the region. But more recently, we have been seeing some authoritarian tendencies in AK Parti, and that is what really caused the events in Gezi Park protest last summer. Were some of you over there during the protest? Did you face any gas?
I managed to get close.
Okay. You were not this close, right?
No.
Okay, that's good. We don't want you that close. Yes, from May to June 2013, which started out as a small group protesting against cutting off the trees in a park, it turned into a major wave of protests nationwide. It wasn't about the park or trees anymore. It became an anti-government protest all across the country. Thousands joined these protests. And what made them bigger is actually the initial police brutality and government response in undermining the protests, not paying much attention and even making a mockery of them. But over time, very quickly, they understood that this was getting serious, and by taking a few steps, they were able to bring the protests down. And now they are not there anymore. It is through government reconciliation that the government agreed to take those construction projects to the court, and then eventually to the people. They retrieved the projects. The radical groups started acting violently and destroying certain material. That is why the larger public started to pull out of those protests. And eventually the protests came down. But in a way, the spirit is still there. Those people who were there protesting, they are still upset about certain developments. And somehow the government seems to have this ability to upset those groups again and again, over and over again. Some argue that it is a deliberate step to polarize the society so that their base, their popular base, becomes stronger in supporting them. What I call this is actually a social pressure of the younger generations on an aging governance. The people who are in government right now, they are at around in their 60s, late 50s, 60s. They are the generation of the 1960s, 70s latest. And they don't really connect well with the generation of the 1990s. And that is really the generation that went out during those Gezi Park protests. The younger generation who even voted for AK Party, they were out there protesting. And that shows that divide. Prime Minister was saying, what is up with this Twitter? Who cares for Twitter? But while millions were organizing over Twitter and joining those protests. And today the government has realized that, and they are organizing themselves in Twitter and everything. So I think the society is asking for more freedoms, more opportunities, asking for a higher standard of freedoms and more of a modern expectations now is raised by the society, by the younger generations, and the current government is having a hard time meeting those demands or even understanding them. There is also the final issue that I would like to discuss is this perceived conflict between the Hizmet and AK Party. Initially, when AK Party first came around and it was winning all these elections, at the base, there is a big overlap in terms of the goals and objectives of both the Hizmet movement and the current governing party. They were pro-European Union, they were pro-democracy, all these democratization reforms and freedoms, and it seemed to overlap with what Hizmet foresaw in terms of Turkey's future. But over time, certain incidents broke this, let's say, close alliance apart. I guess the beginning big signal was the flotilla incident, when a ship was bringing aid to Gaza, Israeli forces attacked the ship and killed 9, and the government took a very, how should we say, a populist, more nationalist kind of approach in responding to Israel, whereas Fethullah Gulen came out and surprised everyone by saying that the ship had to first ask for permission from Israel, because they are the authority in that area. So that was really the first break, but then there has been multiple incidents which deepened that gap. And this is something really a difficult question, because AK Party has 50% of the votes. And it is not hard to imagine that most of those people also at least sympathize with the Hizmet movement. So in a way, people are broken apart. And sometimes this is enforced by the government and the different opportunities that arise. Business people are, you know, they have to choose in between. If you want some government jobs or business from the government, then you have to disassociate yourself from the Hizmet. The perceived threats on both sides is existential. AK Party thinks that the Hizmet will overcome and will take over and will establish a party or will take over government and etc. So it will be the end of AK Party. Whereas some people in Hizmet think that the way AK Party approaches Hizmet right now is basically to bring an end to Hizmet by banning the private courses, for example. This is still a project that the Prime Minister pushes for, the closing of all the private university preparation courses. They don't openly say that this is against Hizmet, but a lot of Hizmet people understand this as an anti-Hizmet move. The most recent thing in the last couple of weeks is closing off private apartments for students. And of course, Hizmet serving education and students, there's a lot of students and housing where students live, and this is again perceived as a potential threat by the government towards Hizmet to bring an end to Hizmet. So it is, the threat is perceived as existential, although both Fethullah Gulen and Recep Tayyip Erdogan, in their public statements, they embrace each other. They, like Fethullah Gulen said, he prays for Recep Tayyip Erdogan. Erdogan has been attending some of the functions of Hizmet. But at the bottom level, there is this growing distrust. And especially as we are moving closer to the elections, there will be a presidential election and governmental election and mayoral election over the next couple of years. Things are getting warmer in Turkey. And just today, there was a statement by the Journalists and Writers Foundation, which is the representative organization for Hizmet. They made a statement. And in this statement that you can't read, they identify the problem, which is that some claim that Hizmet movement is working to establish a political party, and they denounce this. This is actually a claim that Fethullah Gulen over and over again has spoken against, that no Hizmet associated people should establish a party. We can't get involved in politics. It is a no-no for Hizmet. But still, there are some arguments like that, and they issue 3 points. If we read it very quickly, it is impossible for the community consisting of volunteers from different political ideologies to establish a political party directly or indirectly to be affiliated with any political party, which is another false, unfounded claim that is occasionally voiced. And here are some values that are supported by his man that are mentioned. Nurturing no goal other than serving mankind. The community recommends that the volunteers who are devoted to this goal should define their relationship with politics against certain values and principles, particularly including human rights, democracy, transparent and fair administration, pluralism, the rule of law, and freedom of faith and expression. Any political party that properly upholds these values is preferred. So if in the next elections, the People's Republican Party comes out and supports these values, he's not going to support candidates from that party as well. And lastly, they say, it is legitimate and beneficial for the country for anyone to engage in politics. So if someone from Hizmet, as an individual, makes a personal decision to pursue a political career, basically we can't stop that. Community's principle of not establishing any party and not being affiliated with any political party should not be confused with certain individuals' personal preferences to engage in active politics, even if they have links to the community. So, exciting times are waiting for in Turkey in terms of political situation, but the society is growing and that transformation is moving forward. And no matter what happens at the political realm, I believe that in the medium run, in Turkey, good days are ahead. Thank you for listening.